Jews lived in
my town?
Yes.
Oh, about 300 families. Yeah, and they were all Shomer Shabbat. No, there was a cheder. My brothers went to cheder, but for the we had to go to the public school. So that's why my brother was not in school, because we had a cheder. In matter of fact, kind of horror. My house had a house of boys. My father took a malamed for our boys. We had the boys in the malamed in our house. My mother taught me to knit and to crochet and handwork. There is no handwork that I don't know, because my fingers were always, I never sat idle. And to read, let it be in Yiddish, the newspaper. In Sachner they had Yiddish newspapers. My father brought it home, and I read it perfect in Yiddish. Also, I learned it. My father helped me to it, or I had a Rebbetzin who gave me private lessons. Her husband was a dayan in our town. I would not remember the name. He passed away, and she made her panusa teaching girls. She didn't make a bisyanka. She had two girls, three girls here and there, and she taught us davening, or read, or write in Yiddish. No youth organizations, no, because this was children grew up in houses that the parents wouldn't let them go no place.
Shabbos, you would just sit at home?
No, not sit at home. The boys had their own place in our Oshiurim, but the girls were. But the Hungarians, girls, I was not allowed to go already on the street without a shomer. My father wouldn't let me. It was wartime, and soldiers came around through our town, and soldiers were there. I was not allowed to go out from the house just with a shomer.
But this was really 1939,
40. The beginning in 40 till 44, till we were deported, it was really, really bad. Bad.
Before that, in the house, you were protected, you didn't feel?
No. Except when we went out to school. I mean, the house was a normal Yiddish house. And everybody, we tried to live as normal as possible. Except we had to fast every Monday and Thursday. Even the children.
Who made that takana?
The Satmar Rebbe.
You were Satmar Hasidim?
That's right. That's right.
The whole town?
Yeah. Yeah. We knew that. And that was not just one month. That was going on, that I remember, for years.
So your father would often go to the Rebbe?
Yeah.
With your brothers?
No. The children didn't go, no. My father went. Even when we came to live in, after the war, we came to, we lived in New York. First we lived on in Canada, and then we lived in New York. The first year I sent my husband to go to the Satmar Rebbe for Yom Kippur. And my husband told him whose son-in-law he is, and the Rebbe remembered. we didn't believe it, that that's going to be the end, that they're going to take. We didn't believe it. We always said, I asked my father, what's going to be the end? He says, Hashem will help. That was the answer. And we have to have the betuchen, and we Hashem will help. But the end was, we heard, we went to the city, and we saw the German Jews were already in cattle cars. They started with the German Jews. Cattle cars were standing in the train station.
In Satmar,
full of Jews, and they were begging just for a little water. They were ready to give anything, just give them a little water. And nobody was allowed to talk to them, because they were the Hungarian soldiers, and they were just plain soldiers. They were told that nobody should go to them. It was already, the war was on already between Germany and England. So it was, we felt it very bad, very bad. And to stand by and not to have those Jews to give them a drink of water, that was the worst. The ghetto life is just in, I can't even describe it. Because people, they couldn't believe that they gather everybody from their homes. Everything is flowing, the morning, in the daytime, in the nighttime, and in the next morning, everybody's gathered up, and you have to go, you leave everything. In the house, in the ghetto, everybody was assigned to a family. We came to the family, and there were furniture in the house. There were about 7 families from the surrounding cities, from the surrounding area, came to Satmar. And there was designated a few streets. This is the ghetto.
Your ghetto was in Satmar.
Let me tell you, in the morning, one morning I see there were shoppers with svurim, because this man was a buttonmacher where we were assigned. He made the filling. And they took the svurim and they put them on the floor, they took the shoppers, they took it out and they cut it up for burning to cook a meal. So I said to the girl, Kranchu, what you gonna do when we come back? You have no furniture. She says, oh, Narala, Mashiach duzam demuls.
So, what can you answer to that? In her father, told us, Kranchu told me, because I was with Kranchu in Birkenau. We were with my friend through the year. He told us that we should eat whatever they give us, because it's Pekuach Nefesh. We came to Birkenau a day before Shavuos. We wouldn't eat. We were sitting on the sun all day outside. Nobody, I mean, there was nothing to drink and nothing to eat. But still, when they gave us the ration. We didn't eat that ration. That's treif. We gave it to other girls. We were starving ourselves. A few of us girls, we were starving ourselves.
The other girl says, yeah, give it to us, we'll give you for you a potato or a drink. But that never happened. When they opened up the wagons, they just threw out the dead people. They were dead people in the wagons. And we were there.
So you arrived the day, by day or by night?
By day, Sunday morning. I remember we benched the Shchodesh in Shabbos in the train. Sunday, we arrived. But after that line was, as we came down from the train, my mother had 2 pieces of bread put away for me, and she put it for me in the hand. She put it for me in the hand. All right, I didn't say nothing. I mean, she saved it that I should have. She sent me with Crunchu.
And there was a pearl every day?
Yeah, that's right. Not every day, it was 4 o'clock in the morning. But we were treated like not human. We just had to go where we were told. Otherwise, you get to send away. If you don't do, well, then you just put down your number and you get sent away. That we learned right away. If you don't behave, you get sent away and you never come back.
Who was your blockhouse sister? Do you remember?
No, some Jewish girl.
How was she treating you?
It's not nice to. Should I talk about a Jewish girl? Yeah, she learned from the Germans, you Schweinhund. That's what we were. We were not human by them. We were Hundschwein. Or Schweinhund, whatever they felt like. We were just a number. We were not human by them.
Food, what did you get? You said at the beginning you wouldn't. You refused to eat.
We refused to eat, and then we had. Constipation, and then they wouldn't even let us stay in the toilets. They were chasing out because they didn't have enough toilets. They had to chase people to finish fast because the next group has to come. I'll tell you, I never mentioned food. I was never a big for food. So that didn't matter to me. Bread, no bread. We got that portion bread and a plate of soup, and that's all. That's all. I mean, everybody came home just skinny. But some people are big, better eaters, and some people are not. And I never complained. I never mentioned that we, even now I didn't mention, because by me,
it didn't bother you so much. You
no.
Didn't feel hungry.
Well, I felt hungry, I had no breira.
It didn't bother you.
I had no breira. By me, mostly the dirt that was unbearable, the dirt. In Pitom, we are just in a place and we're waiting for the Malachamuas, when he's gonna come. So everybody can write a book from a day where the Machshava was. We were not by ourselves. We didn't believe this is happening to us. We couldn't believe it. Yesterday we had a home and we were occupied, and we were doing what is the time and the place,
in here we're waiting for the Malachamuas. We said there were girls that they knew Tehillim by heart. So we gathered together and we used to say a poor kapitlach Tehillim. But that's all, because those who didn't know it by heart, they couldn't even keep up with them, because we were saying how lucky they are, they know it by heart, and we have just to listen to that.
I remember now, you're mentioning Erev Tisha B'Av. In the camp, did you know when it was Tisha B'Av, when it was Yom Kippur?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Somehow we knew, yes. We knew when it was Pesach, we knew when, because in Bergen-Belsen was the Satmar Rebbe for that Pesach. And we came in, we walked to Bergen-Belsen, then they were, when the, we walked, yes, we walked by the family camp. And we were told there were some people. A sister was in my group, and a brother was with the Satmar Rebbe. And he talked by the gather that this is the place where the Satmar Rebbe is. And that was a family camp. We zan Chassidim. They had Pesach there. And after Pesach, they moved them to Switzerland, Satmar Rebbe, and we were there waiting in the camp. They told us a few more days and then you will be over.
Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur,
we knew, and we did fast at Yom Kippur. We knew. Somehow there we had an Italian woman in the factory where we were working, and they somehow got a luach. They put their hands on a luach, and there were girls in my group that they got that luach, and then we knew everything. We knew that the Yom Haroim, we knew it. And we knew the Yom Kippur, and we fasted Yom Kippur. Oh yes, we were really helping each other. Oh yes, the three of us. We just, I had relatives, but I chose to stay with us. First of all, Crunchy, my mother said, stay with Crunchy. There I was, that was the beginning, and then we were together, the five of us. And there are other women were also, they stuck together, and that helps to survive.
Can you describe a bit what you saw when you arrived in Bergen-Belsen?
Yes, I can describe. There were mounds and mounds of dead people. And not covered, just dead bodies. They died. They gathered so many people. Sick people, and they walked them so long that they just perished when they came there. And we saw big, and then the typhus broke out. When we came there, slowly, everybody got sick. And they just perished there. I know, my Crunchy was very sick. She had diarrhea, and she asked me just a drink. So I went to the lager Elster, wherever they were, and I asked her, I must have some liquid. So she gave me a little, because she knew me. She's also from Satmar. She knew me, she gave me, I took it to Kranchu. She should drink. And Kranchu will never forget that, how I saved her life with a little coffee. So that those, we were near, our barracks were near the flares. In one nice day, I think it was in New Year's, the bombs came, and the bombs were designed for the flares. They bombed our barracks. We were in the bunkers, and when we came back, everything was burned down. And there were a few girls sick in the room. They didn't went down in the bunkers, and they were burned there. That was once. Then they put up a makeshift barracks very fast. 2 weeks later, we come off from the bunkers. Those makeshift barracks were also gone. Yes, we're very happy here. We're happy. My husband gets big covered in his shul. We donated a Sefer Torah in the parents' name. I told my husband, I never took up any wages. I want to have a Sefer Torah. So we did it 5 years ago.